Hi and welcome to AXSChat. We're delighted to have Gavin Neate with us today. Gavin has started a company called Neatebox and he's doing some amazing stuff with particularly with crossings, pedestrian crossings, and also with beacon technology that's enabling people to have access to public spaces that they wouldn't necessarily have had before. So thank you for joining us today, Gavin. I'm really pleased that you can come and talk about what you're doing and also the wider implications of the technology that you're working with. So can you tell us a bit about your background and how you came to set up Neatebox?
Yeah, certainly. Well, first of all, thanks very much for having me on. It's absolutely a pleasure. You guys do great work, so it's absolutely super to have this opportunity to talk in front of the people who watch you. My background, I spent 10 years in the military as a police dog handler. That took me towards becoming a guide dog mobility instructor. That meant that I was training people how to use guide dogs. It was a three-year apprenticeship course, and basically the job was to train the person how to use the guide dog. So match the person with the dog and then train the person how to use the dog. And for the last 18 years, that's exactly what I've been doing. So ultimately, the guide dog mobility instructor's job is to do the last bit of advanced training with the dog. This is like a seeing eye dog in America. Do the last bit of training with the dog, then move the dog towards a specific person. So we interview people and then assess the person, assess the dog, match them together, put them together, train them together, and then we go out there and work them in their own environments and make sure that they're up to a certain standard. Now, after the person's done maybe a 6 to 8 week training course, we then will spend another 6 weeks doing little visits every now and again, and then we'll see them every single year, a bit like an MOT of a car. And because you're out there all the time walking on the streets, you're actually seeing what the person is having to experience on a day-to-day basis. And the more you see that, the more you see things like design factors that really mean influence the person's life. And the more you experience that, the more you realize that sometimes design is not designed around the person. And the more I did that, the more I realized this wasn't just a problem that I was seeing with visual impairment. It was a problem for lots of different people. That kind of pushed me towards trying to come up with a solution. I had no intention of starting a company. I was a guide dog mobility instructor. It was the job I wanted to do for the rest of my life. About 5 years ago, I started a company basically to try and get hold of some of the help that I would get from Scottish Enterprise. When you start a company, in order to get things like help with patents and stuff like that, and lawyers and all these sorts of things, you need to get help from the experts. Scottish Enterprise got involved and they were able to help me. I stayed with guide dogs for another 3 years after that, just doing the company in my lunch hour and after I finished work at night and stuff like that. And basically the idea was to try and prove a concept. Now, if I just go back just slightly and look at the problem itself, you'll notice, anybody who can see this will notice that behind me is a pedestrian crossing. This is the sort of thing that we would have in the UK. It's slightly different in America, but as you can see, there's a red button at the bottom. I've just pressed this, and then when the green man comes on, the green man comes on. Underneath the box is a tactile cone, and that revolves. So that if there's no audible signal, the tactile cone revolves, and the person who's holding onto the tactile cone knows that the green man is on. Unfortunately, if the person's 6 foot away from that tactile cone, they can't feel it. And also, if you get to the curb edge and then you go looking for it, you end up going in the wrong direction. So you ultimately can be a long, long way away from where the button is and then when the tactile cone is. Long cane users and guide dog owners are the only two people that use the tactile cone. There's no other independently mobile, visually impaired, or visually impaired person. You're either guide dog, long cane, or holding onto somebody's arm. So it seemed to me that it was quite obvious that if you designed this bit of kit, a pedestrian crossing, you had to design it, especially with this tactile cone, for a long cane user and a guide dog owner. And the more I was speaking to traffic engineers, the more I was getting the feedback was, oh no, it's for blind people. And it's a lot more in-depth than that. It's actually for people who are long cane users and guide dog owners. And if they don't understand that as a traffic engineer, how can they install it for those people? And we've got an amazing amount of kit under here. I don't know if we can see it, but under here is a tactile cone. Each one of these units costs an absolute fortune, about £500 each. Now, if you've got four of these boxes on a particular crossing, you're paying £2,000 just in the tactile cone unit under here. And if nobody ever uses it, that's a lot of money that we're spending on something that never gets used. And if it's too far away from the curb edge, it's not going to get touched. So ultimately, the company was set up in order to find a way that we could do something instead of having this mechanical, I must find the button, press the button, hold on to the tactile cone sort of setup. So ultimately, what we did was we put it all onto a mobile phone. And I'll just grab my phone. It's here. Just demonstrate it very quickly, and we can go to some more questions in a second, but because I know there will be. When it comes to mobile phones, there's always lots of questions. So what we would do is we would start the application running, and this is, I don't know if I'll pick it up eventually. And it's basically you just press this button down here. This goes looking for pedestrian crossings. When it finds a pedestrian crossing, it says, I found a crossing. You press the button on here, and it presses the button on the pedestrian crossing.
Definitely.
Now, ultimately, all we're really doing here is we're and then it vibrates as well. I don't know if you can hear that, the vibration.
Yeah.
So ultimately, what we're doing is we're putting the button press onto the mobile phone. How we do that, how we get the information onto the phone, what information we put on the phone, is not really that relevant. All we've done here is prove that we can press a button from a mobile phone. If that's in my pocket and it presses the button automatically and it turns on an audible signal, that's what I do. What we needed to do is we needed to give the person who was visually impaired or in a wheelchair, or the person who's pushing the person in a wheelchair, the ability to press the button without having to go looking for it. And that might seem like a really small thing for sighted people or able-bodied people, but when you've got a disability, even just reaching the button if you're in a wheelchair can be a real nightmare. No use of this hand. That hand might be using the control. All of a sudden, I can't even reach the button. And this is a lot lower than it would be. So the company was set up to find a solution to this. We found a solution, put it onto the mobile phone, press the button on the mobile phone. It presses the button on the crossing. And then we can turn on an audible signal or have the phone vibrate for the person who's deafblind or whatever it might be. And I got involved with a lot of people who said they really liked the idea. A lot of people said they didn't know there was a problem. So getting involved with a solution was something that they thought was a really good idea, especially when they realized just how much money was being wasted on the adaptations that we put in and tick the box to say that they are working. And I always use that analogy, it's not an analogy, it's the story of the Emperor's New Clothes, where the two tailors come along to the king and say, I'm going to make you the most amazing clothing in the world. They make invisible clothing, charge him absolute fortune. He gets naked, puts on the clothing, runs outside. He's out in front of all the people going, looking at how fantastic my clothing is. And a little boy goes, wait a second, you haven't got any clothes on. He then gets a little bit embarrassed. Now, to a certain extent, what I've been is I've been the little boy who's pointing at the king and telling him he's not got any clothes on. And that can be underlined. I presented at Warwick University last October at a JT conference with a room full of traffic engineers. And I asked the question, who is the tactile cone for? And all of them said blind people. The tactile cone is for long cane users and guide dog owners. And unless you understand that, you can't install adaptations for people. So that's the outline of the business. That's what I started doing. That's pretty much what it is. If there's any questions, I'm very happy to answer them. I'm sure there will be.
Yeah, well, plenty. Obviously, at the moment, you're using an iPhone.
It's on Apple.
It's the mobile operating system of choice for most people with visual impairments because of VoiceOver and Zoom and all the rest of it. So, understandable choice. I assume that the plan is to be platform agnostic at some stage because
one day
in the dim and, well, maybe bright future, all mobile operating systems will be accessible.
Yes.
Instead, hinting at Rob Sinclair, hinting at the guys at Google. Actually, Google are doing a good job.
I know.
I think that Microsoft are starting to take it seriously again in their mobile operating system. But yeah, I admit most of your audience are using one of these right now. So, but I know that you've created this great product, but you've seen the opportunity to look at other bits of environmental design, and the technology you're using really excites me. It's, you know, beacon technology, from my point of view, I'm very interested in, because not so much around not being able to activate the crossings, because that's a particular niche and you're meeting that need, but I know you're doing stuff in terms of serving up relevant information based on geographical locations. Mm-hmm. And this is really, really of interest to me. But, well, so long as I can make it to the geographical location. So one of the things I'm interested in is routing, and routing within buildings.
Mm-hmm.
Because I don't know how to find my way from one room to the next. Mm-hmm. In a complex building situation, and whether or not it's something you'd consider, in public space, in complex public spaces like stations, museums, etc. And I know that Edinburgh is a complex public space because you've got all of the different lanes and nooks and crannies and everything else. And you've also done something with Edinburgh City Council.
Mm. Yes, I have. Just to sort of, I'm going to go back just for a second, yeah, and just very quickly mention the kit, because obviously it was brought to attention that I'm using iOS. And yes, the reason I was using iOS and started with the iOS was because I had all my clients turning up to train with their guide dogs, and I would train six people at a time, and they'd all end up talking about the kit that they had. And if somebody didn't have it, they'd want to go out and buy it, because that's what everybody else was talking about. They were saying, oh, you can do this, and you can play this game, and you can interact with your friends and family, and you can do stuff that you never thought you could before, and it's all on there. So we can talk about beacon technology, and beacon technology is fantastic technology, but this is the bit of kit. That is the bit of kit. All beacon technology does is it opens up this. Without having accessible hardware, this kit, then we're not going to go anywhere. If you could have the best GPS, the best Wi-Fi, the best beacon technology, and unless the person can actually interact with the kit, then it's useless. True. So, I mean, I'm going to take my hat off right now and say Apple have done a fantastic job. I know that the guys with Android, Samsung and all, Sony and all these guys, they're also doing a fantastic job. TalkBack is a super system. It's a little bit behind because the majority of people are using iOS in my area anyway. However, they need competition. Apple need competition. Samsung need competition. Everybody, Microsoft can be that competition. They've got the resources, and I know that they'll improve and improve and improve until people are going, shall I have the next one, Apple, or whatever. Anyway, so I realized that I could use this for lots of other things. I didn't want to go down the route of mapping. If I was going down the route of mapping, what I would have done, and I know a lot of people have, is I would have found a problem and then shoehorned a solution into it. And that was something I was really aware that I didn't want to do. I didn't want to go, what's the latest bit of kit? How can I shoehorn it into a problem I've got?
Mm-hmm.
What I've always done is I've always found a problem or discovered a problem through personal experience or the experience of my clients, and then I've looked for a solution that suits the problem. And I know a lot of people out there have tried beacons with triangulation and putting them all over stations so that people with visual impairment know where they are.
Yes.
And I haven't gone down that route. In fact, I've purposefully avoided that route because I felt that there's a lot of other things that can do that. And I didn't think it was enough to just say, let's help visually impaired people get from A to B or so that they know where they are. What I wanted to do is I wanted to actually look at specific problems and find solutions. Now, it just so happens that the solution or the problem I found and the solution I used can also be used for wayfinding, as you described it. But what we did was we won a competition with Edinburgh Council a couple of years ago called Edinburgh Apps. It was basically a civic challenge to look at how technology can be used. And what we did was we did the pedestrian crossing. However, in discussing it and realizing that when we were working with this, we were going to need to find some way of actually utilizing the technology in other ways, because this is going to take a long time to get anywhere. And we thought tourism. Now, tourism traditionally is an area where it is very, very difficult for a venue or a tourist attraction to provide all of the things that they need to provide for every single person that's going to walk through the door. And that can be language, it can be Braille, it could be large print, it could be low signs so that people in wheelchairs can read them without somebody having to read them to them. And I was thinking, well, we can still use this kit for that purpose. So we approached Edinburgh Council, and we came up with an idea. Edinburgh High Street is basically made up of a mile with lots of little, moving a bit, see this? Lots of little side streets.
Yes.
And each one of these side streets is about yay wide. And you walk down that side street and you go, wow, this is amazing. It's really dark and sort of a bit dingy and stuff like that, but it's got amazing history because this is 500, 600, 700-year-old city we're in here. So what we did, we started using beacons in all of these places, and we came up with a tourist guide, which was totally accessible if you have this bit of kit. The advantage by using beacons meant that the problem we were solving was the accessibility and the inclusivity, but also we didn't need Wi-Fi and we didn't need GPS. So it was purely our mobile phones talking to the beacon talking to the mobile phone, us walking into an area where we wanted to get information, and the information being opened up because of where we were standing. And it just so happened that the person who was actually maybe wanting to find out where they were would also get information through that as well. So it was like an extra. It was an extra. It doesn't mean that we couldn't do it, but what I wanted to do was help somebody in tourism. Now, if we can put this in every single tourist attraction in Scotland, castles, underground, inside buildings, you name it, then we're actually solving a problem. And then we can monetize it, and then that money can go back into a company that then gets bigger and then starts paying for stuff like this without having to charge the council a fortune, without having to, and we're looking at this being a free app for the pedestrian crossing. It's a free app for the tourism. It's the venue that pays for the actual stuff to go in. So ultimately, what we can do is wayfinding. It wasn't the low-hanging fruit that we needed it to be at the start. Okay. It was more, let's deal with a problem. And we believe, and also get as many people under that umbrella as possible, which is what we hope we've done.
No, I do like the fact that you're able to serve up information, and it can be consumed in whichever way that the person wants. I know Antonio's got a question.
Yes, I do. It's a very interesting idea, and you can almost have a sort of a universal language, because you can have that information displayed in different languages, and people can just access to it. So once you do it in one place, you can do it basically everywhere. But my question was, today you are solving a problem, but there's existing technology out there. So how can we use existing, how can the existing signs can be adapted and adjusted to be able to use this technology to what is already out there implemented, or they will have to buy new signs and put new stuff in order to be able to use this technology?
Yeah, if we look at tourism, I'm guessing that it's a tourism question in this example. All we're really doing is we're providing beacons, which are little self-powered units. We put the beacons in lots of different places, and then the attraction then gets the content together that they want to display. Now, we're not talking hours and hours of content here. We're talking maybe a couple of minutes of a story, so that the person just stands there and gets a story at that time. Now, that can be in any language, as you say. It can be in any text. Now, that does need to be inputted into the software. We've written the software programming for the Royal Mile. We've already had three, it's called Edinburgh Up Close, by the way. You have to visit Edinburgh to do it. But we've already had three reviews, and they're all 5-star reviews, because people are walking around and getting information at the time that they need it without having to worry about data roaming and the rest of it. But yeah, you're right. You do need to install the beacons. Luckily, it's not going to cost an absolute fortune for the beacons. The secret is in the software and the content in the software. And that's ultimately what you have to do. Now, it doesn't necessarily have to cost a fortune. You could potentially just have some information pertaining to a painting, which could just be the name of the artist. Now, if that's all you wanted to do, you could do that. And of course, it would be accessible in VoiceOver or anything like that.
No, because Wikipedia, for some content, there's already Wikipedia pages in different languages. So
Yeah.
part of the content is already it's already there. It's just a question to bring that content into the app.
Yeah, you could drag and drop. I wouldn't trust everything they write on
True.
Wikipedia, but but you're right. I mean, you could just drag and drop into the app, which does, yeah. I mean, it's all very possible.
So
Doesn't have to cost a fortune.
for instance, and I know Deborah's got a question, and but my curiosity's got the better of me here. Would you be able to set your language preferences so that the beacon would recognize that you set a preference for, say, Spanish? And so when you roll up to one of the roads off the Royal Mile, that information is automatically served to you in your native language.
It would already be on the phone. So you're downloading the app, which has got all of the information on, and if you're Spanish, you download it in Spanish. So it's already there.
So, Deborah, your question?
Yes, Gavin, I think it's very interesting what you've done and very needed. And I think we're going to see more and more of this type of thing, and sort of going with the direction that Antonio was going, in that taking existing technology, existing apps, the Internet of Things, the robotics, all of those different things that are converging together, and then solving societal problems, I think is very important. And so, to me, what you have done is you've taken existing technology that could be improved. Hardware, software, the apps, all the stuff, and made sure that it was accessible to, a wider range of people. And so I'm curious if, I think that we almost need to have a global conference where we get people like you and other people together that are solving problems. I know there's some very interesting things happening in the United States trying to map out all the different things and solve these problems, but the So it's almost more of a comment than a question, but I just really think the opportunity to continue to look at what's out there and what's converging and to make things accessible for everybody, maybe starting with accessible tourism, I think that's such an opportunity. And I also think that's sort of the direction that we should take with this access chat, so that it's not just talking about, your solution, but it's talking about a real wide variety of, the solution people like you, Gavin, that are changing the world. So.
Yeah, I think the thing I would really want to underline here, really want to underline, and one of my directors is visually impaired. He's got a guide dog himself, but he would be the first person to give me a kick now if I didn't say that what we are doing here is we're making a solution that is inclusive. I and he and my other members of my team are all about inclusive solutions. We want, if we have 15 people in a room all using this, they can all access exactly the same information. So why do I need to have Braille books? Obviously, some people might want to have Braille, and that's absolutely fine. But would we need in the future to have like massive loads of Braille books when we go to a tourist attraction? And not that we'd be able to do that anyway, because it's just too cost restrictive. If we can have one app that suits everybody, or one piece of hardware that suits everybody, as long as we at the very start look at the design and put a serious work into the design, we can make that accessible to everybody. And the kit's already there. Apple have already got it there. Samsung have got it there already. It's just for us to actually use it and utilize it in our design process, and then everybody can access it. And I would say that the big scary thing for me, and this is where it all falls down, when I go into a phone shop or a cell phone shop, and I go up to the person serving in the shop and I say, I'd like to buy a phone for my mother who's blind. They'll say, oh yeah, here's a nice one with big buttons. And until we can bridge that bit in the middle, you've got all these fantastic bits of kit, and then you've got all these amazing people who really want to use it, be they visually impaired or hearing impaired or wheelchair users, and there's nobody in the middle, really. Apple do a little bit of it, and it might be different in America or around the world, but in the UK, this middle bit, you go into a normal phone shop and they haven't got a clue,
Yeah, I think
generally, about the accessibility features. So
look,
you
even in the Apple Store, and I have a naughty habit of going in there, turning on voiceover, setting it to the Afrikaans voice, setting it to maximum speed, and putting screen curtain on,
I got in trouble for doing that the other day.
and then wandering off.
Yeah, I got into trouble from a visual impairment group who said, "Are you trying to give us a bad name?" So I kind of took a little bit on board there. But you're right. People need to upskill. And it's up to the big companies, Vodafones of the world and O2s and Virgin and all these guys, to make sure that when they sell phones, and they're selling Apple phones as well, to make sure that their staff are upskilled. And then to make sure that the people who are learning to use the kit get training. And this is where it gets really cool, and I love this bit. The training gets given to them or sold to them by people who are visually impaired or disabled themselves. Because let's face it, they're the experts.
The only thing that the people in the stores, they receive when there's a new phone, they receive a piece of paper with the details of, you know, display size, color, and that's it. They don't receive anything else. There's absolutely no training in those shops.
Every single phone store should have a visually impaired person who works there, be that 1 or 2 days a week or even 5 days a week. Why the hell not? And if that happens, then we've got a whole line of people that are going to be queuing up to get these jobs are going to be better than anybody else in that store. Now, surely we're at a time now where hare and tortoise here, the tortoise is overtaking the hare very quickly. The tortoise has to wake up and realize how far behind the curve they are, because these guys are using the technology with GPS and they're using it with voiceover and they're using it under the table at an office meeting through their Bluetooth headset. To do their diary changes without having to, and it's just like, well, guys, they're the experts, and I sit there and go, teach me.
No, in fact, Vodafone, they have a foundation that is actually focused on topics like this. So it will be interesting to present that, to do a proposal to the Vodafone Foundation about this topic.
Oh, wow. Get me involved. I would love to be involved in that. Get staff members out there. Get visually impaired people in phone shops.
I think it's a really valid point, because I had a painful experience taking both my parents, who are in their 70s, to buy new phones. And eventually they did buy the Doro phones, the big button phones with the simple menus and everything else. But they've also got iPads. So they've got all of the inbuilt accessibility features. They love all of the stuff with particularly video calling and all of this, and are very engaged. But you're right, the staff didn't really have the slightest clue. Apple do train their staff. So to be fair, when I put screen curtain on, they usually have it off again quite quickly. But you go down your high street and the average high street phone retailer won't have a clue. And that's something that the big companies, I think you're right, should pick up. Deborah, you had another
point. One thing we definitely want to point out on AXSChat is all of these companies are training their staff. So we're not here, we're not bad-mouthing any corporations or anything like that. And because Vodafone is doing amazing things. And so is Apple. God bless Apple. And so there's a lot of things happening, but I think your point, Gavin, well taken, is that, boy, there's a lot of work to do. Because we still, and that's one reason why we have access. AXSChat is because we want to make sure that these corporations understand the value, these countries, these cities, these museums, everybody understands the value of including all of us, which once again is why I think you have such an interesting story, because you came in through a very interesting way, training police dogs and then service animals and really understanding the community and then seeing this really important need that was not being solved. And so I still think I'm really excited about the future, and the corporations, they really are starting to listen.
I'm going to take that back right now. They are, but we do really need to get them into shops.
I agree. But they're on this. Yeah, they also are listening to these. And so we want to applaud everything that they're doing, but absolutely could we do more? And I love, Gavin, love that every single phone store in the world has at least one person that's blind and visually impaired working in there. And by the way, can we include some people in there that are deaf? And let's make sure we're employing people that are like the rest of the population. I mean, you know, so I just want to make sure we don't accidentally offend anybody, because a lot of good work is being done.
You know what? I'm totally talking from my own personal experience, and that is my experience is not talking to the big organizations like I know that you do. My experience is when I go into the phone shop, and until the visually impaired person goes into the phone shop and gets the service that you know is being put in the foundations, until they get that service, they're going to have a similar opinion to myself. And I want all of these companies to have, I want them to have the best customer service. I want them to be brilliant.
I agree.
And I know they do as well.
Right. And I know that it's a problem, but I do want, I just want to also say that progress is starting to be made. Progress is starting to be made. It's slow. It's painfully slow. But we mentioned Vodafone and Apple and Microsoft. I mean, all of these, Google, they at least are in the conversation now. Boy, there's a lot of work to do. A lot of work to do. But they are. And Gavin, you, I'm not scolding you. You're amazing. We need people like you. I just wanted to make sure that we don't, that we don't accidentally, say that nothing's been done.
I'm fairly certain that tomorrow they'll be contacting me, Deborah, and saying, Gavin, please come and see us. We would love to get your input.
Yes.
I'm sure tomorrow they'll all be saying that.
I think it's a very valid point that Deborah raises, because we have a focus on positivity on AXSChat, which is something that the accessibility industry has been a little bit bad at doing. It's all too easy to bash the big companies. But that said, most of the phones are not sold in the outlets owned by the big companies. They're sold by third parties. They're sold by other retailers, and it's usually there when people are going into those kind of places where they have the kind of experiences that you've just outlined. I think that the bigger companies are making the efforts. But if you sort of walk down your high street, it's different, because every man jack selling phones.
Because that's something we can't forget, is this is a financial decision for the person buying the phone. So so they are going to spend an amount of money, and they are going to use this phone for a couple of years. And if the product doesn't work, it's actually a real problem for them. So it's important that that this is taking into consideration.
I've just come back from Montreal, where I did a talk about technology and this kind of technology. And one of the things that came up was, it's very expensive to get this kit. You go into a shop and you have to pay $50 or $50 a month or £20-30 a month to get that kind of phone. I know that there are loads of iPhone 4Ss out there that will just be sitting in people's houses. We need to get big organizations like RNIB, Guide Dogs, Seeing Eye Charities, we need to get them to get some sort of campaign, get those phones in, and then get them out on training courses with experts on guide dog training or long cane training courses, and actually have people go away with that bit of kit. Knowing that they don't need to have it connected to the internet or the phone, well, it can be connected to the internet if they've got Wi-Fi, and then be able to use bits of kit like this without the need to spend a monthly fee. There's lots of old phones that can be used for that purpose. And I will just say one thing, my own personal experience with mobile phone companies, as you've already said, yours is that they are doing lots of work. My experience of traffic engineers is that when I first started this was push, 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 complain, campaign all the time. But when you start talking to traffic engineers, they are so keen to get it right. They're desperate to get it right. They just haven't had the knowledge. And what I've done is I've crossed that middle boundary. And I now say to guys, look, you don't have to move this closer. I know it's going to cost you a fortune. You can actually press it from a distance. So I can help solve their problems as well. So when it comes to traffic engineers, and I know it will be the same with mobile phone companies, I know that they want to do the right thing. It's people like ourselves and other people that are out there watching this who can help them build that bridge in the middle.
And Gavin, well said, because that's what we're finding. One reason why we created AXSChat is because there's a lot of people, especially in the United States, that are doing a lot of complaining, a lot of suing. And you know what? And God bless them. I'm so glad they've done that. But we also need people like us in the middle that are saying, okay, let us understand both sides. I love the comment you made about the traffic engineers, because I bet most of them, they just never thought about the solution. And so then it becomes more valuable to all of us. So we really, really applaud your efforts, Gavin.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. And here's a 4S. Another one in my drawer.
I've got four. Should we send them to your address, Gavin?
No, I think we need to send them to RNIB or Guide Dogs or one of these big organizations that will have listened to this and will say, do you know what? We can do the training. every single person who turns up for a guide dog or a long cane training course gets a free phone, or they might get one for £20. And then during the course, they just play with it. At night, they're in their room or whatever, if they're doing residential training, and they just learn to Skype, or they learn to play magic piano, or they learn to do VizWiz, or whatever, any one of these fantastic games, a Trivia Crack, which is an absolutely fantastic game. They just learn to play these things, which can be done inclusively.
Yeah. So why don't we do this on Access Chat? Why don't we say on this Access Chat that if you have a 4S, iPhone 4S, send it to RNIB, send it to Guide Dogs. We can start with this.
They're going to be really upset when they get a massive mail drop.
Where's all these first they should be happy. Yeah.
But yeah, well, maybe. I think they need to be involved in some way.
Well, I know a few people there. I maybe have a quiet word with them.
Yeah, me too.
No, because you know, sometimes...
You talk to them first.
No, some of these phones, they were returned back. I know that some of the shops, they have plans where you could return back your old phone when you are buying a new one. So this is out there, so it's possible to do something here.
Yeah, no, I think it should be possible to do a trade-in, because a lot of them, as Antonio said, you get a discount for trading it in. Now, what's not to love, if companies manage to score a few points for their corporate social responsibility policy by helping upcycle these phones and doing social good. I think we've got a new campaign here.
Great idea. Broken screens. All the people that have, I've got a broken screen on the phone, I'll just put it in a drawer, it'll stay in the drawer. Nobody's going to need that. I can't sell it, it's got a broken screen. Well, it can still be used with VoiceOver, and people could still potentially use it.
Yeah.
No, those phones are quite cheap to repair.
Yeah,
and I just upgraded five of them. And we could send it back in, but it wasn't even worth it. If I knew there was an option to give it to somebody for a good cause like this, I would. I mean, we've got them sitting there. They're not even worth anything in the U.S. You can't sell them. There are thousands of them on, eBay. So it's a great idea.
It could be a charity itself. It could be a charity. You just get the stuff in and then recycle it and actually just sell it for very cheap, or have it there so that when somebody does a training course of any sort, they've got a phone that they can play with at night when they've got nothing else to do.
I think that's we're leaving this on a high note. Thank you very much. We've reached the end of our half hour. That's brilliant. You've been a great guest. So thank you, and I look forward to seeing you on Twitter.
Okay.
It's an absolute pleasure. Thank you so much for your time.